much. Good morning, everyone. Let me make sure I share my screen. The fun Zoom things about, you know, our virtual lives right now. Okay. Are you able to see the screen, the slides, Maria?
Yes, we can see them.
Okay, great. And I want to make sure even though I'm not going to look at the chat, but just make sure, you know, just keep an eye on that. Okay. Hi, everyone. Good morning again. My name is Meghna Bhat. I will be presenting on behalf of Prevent Connect at ValorUS, which is formerly known as California Coalition Against Sexual Assault. Just to let you know, in case you don't, you know, Prevent Connect is a national project of ValorUS, and we are sponsored by the US Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The views and information provided in this web conference do not necessarily represent the official views of the US government, CDC, or Valor. With that being said, my pronouns are she, her, hers, as I mentioned, and just, you know, inspired, or I'm still learning in terms of, you know, kind of dismantling ableism and being more accessible. So it's my learning process, but inspired by, you know, one of the recent events organized by Amita Swadhin, if you've heard of them, and their work on mirror memoirs and their team, I want to just give a quick accessibility description of myself for our audiences now. If you have any visual impairments or any other accessibility needs, I am a South Asian woman with dark black hair touching the shoulders. And then I have worn like a vest, a beige vest with some print. And I have worn glasses with blue color frames. So I have dark black eyes and I've worn a red lipstick, I think. So I'm hoping I'm doing some justice to this accessibility process. And again, as I said, I'm learning, so I would appreciate, you know, any other feedback or ideas about that. And I hope this was helpful. With that said, you can find about, you know, as I said, like I talked about Prevent Connect. So you can find Prevent Connect online on Twitter and Facebook. There's an e-learning course. You can be a part of the listserv, and there are different Prevent Connect web conferences that are happening. But what Prevent Connect does is, as I said, as a national platform, but it focuses on primary prevention. So it does not even, you know, it addresses domestic violence, intimate partner violence, sexual violence across the lifespan. And the main focus is preventing before violence starts, right? Tackling those root causes, preventing it from happening from the first place. So the purpose is not only to connect all these different forms of violence and oppression, but also to connect to other prevention practitioners. So it's this beautiful network of prevention practitioners learning together and, you know, problem solving and identifying amazing strategies that are being done in different communities. So if you haven't heard of that, or if you are curious about it, I definitely encourage you to check out the website. Maria has posted it on the chat. It's preventconnect.org. If I'm talking fast and if you would like me to slow down, please feel free to let me know in the chat. I will do my best to just talk slower as well. So these are some of the web conferences that are coming up from Prevent Connect. There's one on June 29th. If you go to the main website of Prevent Connect, you will see these and you can register for them. This is about manhood 2.0 implementation. And then the other one is on racial justice. This was a part of the COVID pandemic web conference series that ValorUS or Prevent Connect is collaborating with the National Sexual Violence Resource Center. So if you have been a part of those series, you kind of have an idea. This is a fifth workshop as a part of those series, and that's happening on July 14th. So for today's web conference, our learning objectives is describing how storytelling can be instrumental in promoting positive social norms, how to engage our communities to talk about prevention, how to prevent sexual and domestic violence. We are also going to be identifying strategies to engage our communities in candid, constructive dialogues, which, you know, kind of helps to prevent violence, but also create that culture change, right? And without, you know, with any strategy and any tools that we learn. Hello. Oh, I think someone. Yes, Harpreet, I will talk slower, definitely. Sorry about that. I'll be more mindful. So the third learning objective is to identify potential hurdles and ethical considerations, right? While using these tools. So any prevention tools or strategies we use, we know there are certain hurdles or hiccups that we say when we are trying to engage those specific communities. So we're going to be identifying those as well. Like any web conference or workshop that I have done for storytelling, I usually do mention that whatever I do address and cover is not an exhaustive list, right? As a storyteller myself, as a survivor, as a facilitator and a preventionist and an advocate, I myself am learning in this process. So I hope to hear about your ideas, your feedback, your strategies in the chat. As Maria mentioned, that we do have a few chat questions. So I hope you can respond to that and provide us, you know, provide me that expertise and insight of what's working in your communities. So I know we have a polling question right now. How familiar are you with using or facilitating storytelling activities? I'm curious to know about my audience.
Great, so we've got majority of folks who have voted. We'll leave it open for just a little bit more, but we have a really good variation, Meghna. So far, most people say not familiar, but each other one has at least one, one choice. So we have, I'm going to go ahead and stop polling here, and I'm going to share the results with folks. So it looks like the majority of people are very familiar, 33%. Then we have 25% who are not familiar. We have 17% familiar and so-so, and then we have 8% clueless.
Okay, thank you for sharing, and thanks, Maria. I appreciate everyone being so candid and honest about it. I feel sometimes, even as a storytelling facilitator, there's certain things that I'm constantly learning, as I mentioned. So I appreciate each one of you really being here and, you know, providing your time and being present for this web conference. So thank you, Maria, for sharing that. I know we have another poll. Have you attended a storytelling web conference or workshop in the past?
Great, so folks are voting at this moment. We're kind of shifting quite a bit. It looks like right now the answer that has the most is yes, I have attended a web conference or training on storytelling in our movement or work. And again, that's shifting a little bit. We have the majority of folks who have voted. So I'm gonna go ahead and end the polling now and share those results. It looks like the majority of people, about 42%, have said that they have attended a web conference in the movement or work. We have next 25% who said, no, I'm very new to storytelling and have not participated in any storytelling activities or trainings. And then we have a tie between yes, but only outside my work and maybe not sure.
Okay, great. Sorry, just give me one second. I think my, there. Can you all see my PowerPoint or no? Oh, there.
Yes, we can see.
Okay, sorry, it's just at one click. Thank you, Maria, for sharing those results. And thank you everyone for participating in these polls. I'm so glad that, you know, a majority or at least half of you have got some experience with that, like at least attending a workshop. And even those who are very new to this, again, welcome to all of you. And again, thank you for being a part of this session today. So one of the things I really like talking about this is in terms of storytelling, right? Like, how did I get into this work? I think just being a survivor of sexual violence, it took me a long time to find my voice and acknowledge that I had experienced these traumatizing, traumatizing instances of sexual harassment and street harassment and sexual violence. And also have witnessed domestic violence in many ways among my close loved ones. So at the National Sexual Assault Conference, and like I think 3 years ago, at Sujata Baliga's workshop, I was there to provide emotional support. And I that really motivated me. She really inspired me to think about how to get involved with storytelling. And that also, like, not just in terms of, I don't want to be using storytelling today just as a buzzword, right? It's more than that. So just to give you an idea, like, this quote always inspires me, and I'll get to the quote in a second, but to give you some context that I did get trained in digital storytelling at Story Center. You may be familiar with that organization. It's a fabulous nonprofit organization in Berkeley doing some amazing digital storytelling work across the country. So I shadowed their workshops, I volunteered, I took their oral story, I took their digital storytelling workshops, and I also dabbled in oral storytelling workshops in Sacramento. So as I said, like, I'm still learning how to be mindful of not using storytelling as a buzzword and to go beyond those nuances and complexities to make these spaces inclusive and accessible for storytelling, right? So the quote that is on the slide, if you read it, every time I read this quote, I'm able to interpret it or, you know, understand it in different ways, right? Stories move in circles, they don't move in straight lines. So it helps if you listen in circles. There are stories inside stories and stories between stories. And finding your way through them is as easy and as hard as finding your way home. And part of the finding is getting lost. And when you're lost, you start to look around and listen. I feel as daunting and intimidating or vulnerable it can feel to be getting lost in the stories, I feel it's also an exciting time, right? You really, as a human being, as a community, we just start looking around more, actively listening, being deeply mindful, being compassionate, holding spaces for each other. So I just wanted to set this web conference and session, you know, keeping in mind this context. And if you have any, again, you know, ideas, questions, if you're like, hey, this, I'm able to relate to this, or, you know, in these communities, this may be a challenge or something like that, feel free to put it in the chat. You don't have to wait for a chat question, you know, to share your views and your ideas. With that being said, done. I also want to speak about what is storytelling. When we talk about storytelling, it can come up in so many ways, right? I know we are all aware of this, but to make sure that we are on the same page, in this session and the work that I do and the work that I'm going to talk about is about storytelling in our movement and beyond, which are true and personal narratives. Right? Their lived experiences and they're shared in first person. So first person is a style in which the person telling the story is the person the story is about. We see things from their perspective and point of view. Right? So storytelling is many things to many people, and I'm not here to define or impose that definition for you, but this is also to give that framing for what storytelling looks like, or at least in terms of my training and my expertise. I had read this quote online, and I was not able to find who had said it. And I mean, it may be a very general statement, so it's definitely uncredited, but it says, we are all storytellers, whether we realize it or not, right? And I also want to be mindful that storytelling is not to be confused or not to be substituted as therapy or counseling. I want to be very clear of that. Like, storytelling has been always been a part of like therapy or counseling, right? Like maybe like a tool, a strategy, like group support, group therapy. But it is not to be used as the sole or the only substitute for therapy or counseling. So I just wanted to keep that in mind while we proceed with this session. Any questions so far? Okay, I'm making sure. Great. So my story is I had attended a web conference this December, which I feel like is ages ago, by Prevent Connect and Resonance Network. And one of the guest presenters had beautifully introduced herself in this form of storytelling. I think it was Sarah Curtis from Men as Peacemakers. And I know I've used this different way of active, you know, like a storytelling activity in different ways, right? So I love the way she and many of the storytellers have shared their story of who they are. So the story is like, who I am, right? Or who am I? I know there are different adaptations of this activity and believe like the original Where I Am From poem by George Ella Leon, if I'm not mistaken. So I'm going to introduce myself in that style. As you see, there's quite a few photos here. And I do want to give a visual description. The one in black and white right here are my grandparents. They passed away many, many years ago, but I grew up with them, especially my grandmom. Those are my parents on their wedding day. And then that's me with my karate nunchucks. I did learn karate for a few years, and I was a big fan of Bruce Lee because my dad used to watch it, and I loved that. So that's just more of a show-off statement. I really did not know karate that well. And that's with my younger sister, the photo, and that's me at the Capitol in Sacramento, where I'm based, promoting Anti-Street Harassment Week, which usually happens in April. And the board says, "Catcalls are not compliments. Hashtag stop street harassment." So I like giving a visual this of who we are. We are, you know, we are so much than one role and identity, right? So for me, I would like to introduce myself in these different ways. And we're going to be doing that in the chat as well. So I would like to hear your stories, what you feel comfortable sharing about yourself. So I'm going to give an example. I am a first generation immigrant, an older daughter, and an older sister. I am an amateur acrylic artist, brisk walker, plant whisperer, plant mama, and a dancer, especially to the tunes of Bollywood music. I am a foodie and love Indian street food called chaat, along with my share of South Indian meals like idlis and dosas. I come from the chaotic and noisy, yet wonderful and culturally diverse city of Mumbai in India. I come from the land of spices, small businesses, food vendors, and cutting chai stalls on streets. But I also come from a family of teachers and educators, with my mom being a math teacher for almost 30 years. I come from a community where I witnessed intergenerational cycles of emotional abuse as a child, and then sexual harassment and sexual violence as a teenager. I come as a South Indian who regrets losing in touch with speaking my native language, which is Konkani. I'm a fierce feminist, a survivor of sexual violence, a preventionist, and a storyteller. And last but not the least, I come as someone who's learning and believes in the power of transformative and restorative justice in repairing the harm and preventing the cycles of abuse. So this is about myself, right? I came from India like 17 years ago to Philadelphia, did my master's, and came to Chicago to do my PhD. I came to Sacramento to actually work for CALCASA, which was known as then. I worked as part of the Prevent Connect team for a year, then I was an independent consultant and a storytelling facilitator. And then from last year, I joined ValorUS, formerly known as CALCASA, as a project coordinator. And now I'm a project manager for the intervention work. So that's my background. But you're going to do the storytelling activity. And I want to be also, keep an idea of the time. But as you saw that I introduced myself with these prompts, right? So it would be, you can take a couple of seconds to write it in the chat, but I'm going to give you the prompts in the next slide. These are the prompts. So you're going to be writing like a statement about yourself using these starting prompts. I am, and then you can complete your sentence. I come from, and then you can complete your story. And I come as a. the same thing. It can be place, sight, sound, smell, aroma, your identity, family, community, race, anything. Feel free to share these stories, what you feel comfortable sharing in the chat. I don't want you to feel compelled to share something that you're not ready to share in with your peers today in the session. I just want to make sure, did anybody have any questions or was that clear so far? You can put it in the chat. So I'm hoping to get responses to these prompts in the chat. Yes. Okay. So it's I, and if you feel like you don't want to like address all the three, you can just address one of them. You can just complete one of these starting prompts. You can write a statement about one of these, if not all the three. And I would like to hear what your stories are about. I am, I come from, or I come as a. And I can see people are typing. I'm going to give you all a couple of seconds. And then we can always come back to that again. I know these things take some time to write, process, right? I come as a CSA survivor, as a mentor for sexual assault survivors. Thank you, Joyce. Michelle, I start my story when I'm 19 years old and full of hope. Okay, thank you. Thank you for sharing your stories. I'm going to give some time and I hope to hear some more statements and responses to the story in the chat. Take your time. As I mentioned, I will come back to this in the next, during the next transition. So please do write in the chat. I would love to hear who are you, right? Who are you about and what are you about kind of thing, your identity, what gets you excited and what's your story about? Someone said, Joyce, sorry, I could not see your name. A mother of adult sons, divorcee, a widow, an 81-year-old activist for survivors. Wow. Thank you, Joyce, for sharing. Anna says, I'm from Central Ohio, a diverse and eager community. I come as a learner and advocate for survivors. Andy says, thank you, Anna. Andy says, I'm a white cis woman and queer partner. I come from New Jersey and I come as a survivor, educator, and learner. Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing and being so vulnerable and trusting the space and process. Is it Harpier? I'm hoping I'm pronouncing. Please feel free to correct me. You come from the South, the land that is protected by the Andes Mountain. You come as a woman, mother, a daughter, wife, a friend, an advocate for DV survivors. Thank you. Colette says, you're a Chicana activist, social worker, and strong family advocate. I'm a mother, grandmother, and daughter. I come from a dysfunctional family of violence and abuse who married a violent man. I come as a survivor and a mentor and a role model for others. Thank you so much, Colette, for sharing that. And Michelle, thank you for clarifying. I appreciate y'all, again, as I said, sharing those parts of the story, those parts of the identity. And as I said, like that's, we don't want to be defined by that one experience or one role, or maybe we do want to, we don't know, right? Each one, each one's process is so different and to be respected, right? So I appreciate, and I'm really grateful for all of you sharing that. I'm going to read Margaret's and then I'll come back to it later. Margaret, you shared that you come as a woman from the Great Plains of Nebraska by way of public service in Colorado. You're a mother, wife, and an ally for all identities. Thank you. These are so powerful and beautiful, like beautiful not at anybody's expense, but the way you all have framed your stories and the way you all have shared it. So again, thank you so much. I'm curious to know that, how are you going to use the storytelling activity in your work to prevent violence? I see some more chat as well, so I'm going to come back to you. Please don't do this. I will come back to you for sure. But I was just like, I want to see that now you all have participated in the storytelling activity when you all are writing this down. How could you envision using this activity in your work to prevent violence? So feel free to type it in the chat. I'll be back with this If you have any questions or if you did not understand the question, please put it in the chat, you know, post it in the chat and we'll, I'll come back, you know, I can always repeat the question again. Okay, I'm curious to know how you're going to use the storytelling. Do you think it's going to work in your communities? That's also there because not the storytelling activity may not work for all communities in all settings, right? So storytelling and social change, one of the reasons why, and I'll look at the chat in a couple of minutes. The storytelling and social change, I would like to, you know, kind of address it in terms of breaking intergenerational cycles of abuse. The one of the reasons why I got into storytelling is not, I mean, is of course, I don't want my journey as a storytelling facilitator or as a storyteller to be just focusing on, you know, the, how do I say, the, those unpleasant traumatizing experiences, right? I also want to focus on the things that actually helped me transform, made me stronger, made me more resilient. I want to focus on the joyful moments, right? Things that make me smile, that things that give me the strength to move on and learn in this moment. So it ranges from all these different experiences for myself. That's my personal journey. So one of the reasons where I saw storytelling and social change, like creating social change, is not only just breaking intergenerational cycles of abuse, but also like eradicating those root causes of sexual and domestic violence. Engaging communities in dialogues and call to actions. And communities especially that are hard to get, right? Hard to reach, or they are more conservative. They have cultural taboos. It could be any of these communities. It's also storytelling helps to highlight those connections between gender violence and social injustice, some things that sometimes we often forget the bigger picture, right? It creates norm and culture change. How preventing and sexual domestic violence promotes gender equality and equity. So I see a few responses and I will look at that, but I did want to put these because I feel like these are some things that, you know, you may, you know, kind of, it is very relatable, right? We are able to use this, these different framing strategies or frameworks, right? In storytelling and beyond storytelling in our work as preventionists. So mapping our roles in social change ecosystem. I love this model and this work that Deepa Iyer does. She doesn't focus on storytelling, but I feel this can be applied to storytelling, right? Maria also posted the chat, the link for this social change ecosystem. I definitely encourage you to check out Deepa Iyer's work in terms of like racial justice and social change and how storytelling can be contextualized within this framework. As you see that this is the broader ecosystem, right? One of the things that she says that as she listens to and understands what others are doing and how they are reimagining what is possible in this moment, Deepa Iyer ask us to reflect and ask yourselves, what are your values? How can you be aligned and in right relationship with them? What are the needs of the communities who anchor you? And what can you offer with your full energy? And I feel as a storyteller or as a storytelling facilitator, we are not just the storytellers in this ecosystem, but we play a role as healers. We play as a role as disruptors. I can be a caregiver and a visionary, for example. And we may be, all these roles may be very interchangeable. We may be able to apply to all of these as a storyteller or as a facilitator. I just wanted to put this in terms of the framework, and I really love this work because I want us to think of storytelling, not just the technical and the process or the technical aspects of the storytelling process, or how do you do storytelling, but also how do you think of this in our moment, right? In our moment to end sexual and domestic violence. So intergenerational trauma, one of the reasons why I said about social change is one of the reasons why I got into the storytelling is intergenerational trauma. I had witnessed at a very young age, my loved ones being emotionally abused and gaslit by other members of the family or community who themselves had experienced intergenerational years of abuse, right? And I saw how that carried from one generation to another. And as a child who lived in fear, I was really scared about that. I did not understand when there's so much of love and where there's so much of love, why is there so much of conflict? Why is there so much of disrespect, right? So just to, frame what intergenerational trauma means is when trauma is not resolved, when trauma is subsequently internalized, and when passed on from one generation to another, right? Many of us, especially if we belong to marginalized groups or vulnerable identities, our present trauma continues as well. It is different from intergenerational trauma, but the intergenerational trauma definitely can seep into being present trauma, especially if these different forms of oppression and violence continue even to today, which we know that happens, right? That is happening in many ways. So this is to just contextualize about how storytelling will look at these different aspects without really being very obvious about it, right? You can still reach out to your audiences or use it as a cathartic tool to talk about your journey without really, if you don't feel comfortable sharing about your experience, you can still talk about it and destigmatize or remove some of the stigma and the taboos from addressing sexual violence or talking about mental health, for example. So intergenerational cycles of violence may look different for everyone. There are so many complexities and nuances within the intergenerational cycles of violence, right? Because again, it may look different for everyone. The current generations may have more privileges, more access, for example, to mental health and counseling or seeking help. Again, that may not be true for all communities, but I'm just throwing out certain examples. There is also shame and stigma, which we all know that happens, not just about mental health, but about different aspects of gender violence, right? About sexual health, reproductive health. There's so much of shame and stigma that the education is not being provided to kids and youth because of that. Cultural values and perceptions, again. And last thing is the forgiveness and reconciliation. I know as a part of my experience growing up, there was a lot of forgiveness and reconciliation about the about the conflicts, about the emotional abuse, about the disrespect and, gaslighting that had happened, right? And nobody said, oh my God, there was gaslighting. But now when I learned about it, I realized that that was a part of it. And there was a lot of forgiveness and reconciliation, and it looks different for everyone, and it may not apply to many families of survivors. So when I share this, I want to be very mindful saying that I'm not imposing this on anyone, but I realize that this happens in many communities. That is sometimes maybe a privilege, there may be a mediator. And again, that's not an option for many families and survivors. As we know that, not all communities have these spaces to forgive and move on, right? So I also wanted to be very careful about saying that this comes in different ways. So I do have a short film that I would like to show. This is a part of the storytelling. So as a part of the Story Center, there was a project called Stories of Home. And the project was basically for immigrant and refugee women. And we were each paired, I was one of the participants, and each of us were paired with a visual artist, a woman artist. So, basically, I said the story, I said the voiceover, I shared my vision about the story to the visual artist that was paired with me. Her name was Maureen. And she, using her unique creative artistic skills, was able to bring life and color to my story. So this is one type of a story, digital storytelling project. it was a very unique, very cathartic, very affirming experience for me. So I'm hoping to show this. There are other films in this playlist, and that should be, I'll put it in the slides later, and you can also click on this when we send you the slides. But I do want to you know, mention that you can check out the other stories for the stories of home. With that being said, I'm just looking at the chat to make sure. Some of you have worked, put on those responses. And I see, let's see. I think last was Carmen, you introduced yourself. You're the daughter of a Cuban refugee. You come from a longing to connect with your culture and a promoter of equality. And then I see a couple of responses about how you would use a storytelling activity is you learn through case studies so you can humanize and personalize experiences. It breaks down the silos people believe they are in. And using storytelling to relate my personal story of abuse and survival, and also creating respect and validating a person's experience from your perspective. Thank you. And then Michelle, you said that you do it for educating and inspiring and showing your transformation. Okay. Thank you so much, all of you. This is amazing. I get to learn from each of you as well. With that being said, let me show the film. Y'all can see the YouTube, right? Okay. I am gonna try to see if I can see the video panel because I couldn't see anybody's faces. Okay. Let me see if you can hear.
I cannot believe it's been a year. We weren't a perfect family. We had our share of struggles and conflicts. I loved spending so much time with you since mom and dad worked full time. Aayi mak bhook lagla, I would say, after returning from school. You told me, how tugal karte kaale doodh kella. I happily sat and enjoyed my lunch. You knew me so well. I was not a fussy child. If you didn't have time to cook, I was at peace with this favorite dish. It was our tradition until I left for college. Remember, when we traveled to Mangalore, our native place in Karnataka? We took a Volvo bus from Mumbai for Akka's wedding. I held your hand as I watched the villages flash by through the window. No wonder I got the passion to travel. Every year for my birthday, you made gulab jamun, my favorite sweet. And every July, I have spent my birthday away from you. I missed you and craved it, especially this year. Dad told us you were married at such a young age, so you could not complete your education. Yet, you did your best to read English newspapers and ask us questions. You always motivated me and my sister to study. You believed in us. Your two granddaughters are now educated, independent women. How is life there? You asked me when I visited home from the US. Your eyes sparkled with curiosity. You were eager to see life outside India through my stories and photos. I know you were suffering and in pain the past few years. Even though I saw you on video chat for a few minutes a week before you left us, I regret not telling you in person how much I love you. We miss you, Aayi.
So everyone was able to see the film. I was just making sure from start to the end. So, okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Herbert. It was It was a year after my grandmom had passed away in India. Grew up in Mumbai. So I did the story at that time. There are other stories, as I said, in the playlist that address this wide range of experiences of being an immigrant and a refugee or a refugee, you know, especially identified if you're identifying as a woman kind of thing. So it is very relatable in many ways. So I hope you get to see it. And I know they do sometimes have stories of home workshop where they invite people to participate in their workshops as well. So check out storycenter.org. They have some amazing projects where you can be a part of the workshop. If they have funding, you know, you can be a part of the workshop free kind of thing. You know, you don't have to pay as far as I know it. So I hope you enjoyed the story. That was a story that, you know, that's only one of my story, which is on YouTube. I have made a couple of other stories, which I've yet to like do the final edits, short films, as a part of my digital storytelling training. One of the reasons why I shared this film is also to address that, as much as I made this film and I honor and miss and love my grandmom, and, you know, I also had seen this very different side of hers where she was also, you know, traumatized, but also did not know how to deal with that, right, at that time, because there was no conversation about any form of abuse and violence and, you know, power and control at that time, especially when she was married at a young age. So I did see her not realizing and struggling with that as well. So I just wanted to, you know, I share that because, as I said, those nuances and complexities with intergenerational cycles of violence, I could see that how, you know, that ended up with her treating my mom and me and everybody else with a lot of love, but at the same time, things like there were times and conflicts where, as a child, I could not understand what was going on. Like, why was she, you know, she's amazing. She was amazing and she's lovable and she took care of us. And then at the same time, like, why is she being indifferent? And, you know, why is she talking this way? So it was really hard. And I'm sure they themselves did not know that at that time. So it's so difficult naming those things when you don't have any cultural awareness or knowledge of any form of gender violence or abuse at that time. And that's why personal storytelling for me is all about social change. It's not just about addressing those unpleasant, traumatizing experiences. Yes, we can address those as well, but it's also about talking about like my journey and my story about my grandmom and who those beautiful memories that I hold on to when she passed away, or anything else, right? So just wanted to give you an idea about, again, storytelling is not just a buzzword, right? It's more than that. So when we talk about personal storytelling and social change, we do have a polling question here, and I'm curious to know, what is your intention with storytelling? And I know these are some of the questions may sound a little different or repetitive, but it is a different way of capturing this information for me as well.
So the majority of folks have said that they wish to facilitate storytelling circles in their communities. Then we have you are or wish to be a storyteller, and then coming in last is you wish to bring storytelling in your communities but not facilitate. And so I'll leave it open just for a little bit longer. There's still a few folks who haven't had the opportunity to share. So give you all just a few more seconds to answer if you feel compelled to. And then I'll go ahead and end the polling here and share the results. So it looks like 45% of folks, Meghna, said that they wish to facilitate storytelling circles in their communities. And then there's a tie between they are or wish to be a storyteller at 27% and you wish to bring storytelling in your communities but not facilitate, also at 27%.
Thank you so much, Maria. And thank you everyone for participating in the poll. Yes, absolutely. I'm glad to know that y'all are interested. You know, many of you are interested in facilitating these story circles in your own communities, and you wish to be a storyteller, or you wish to bring storytelling, but you're like, you know, I'll provide all the support and create the space. But you know, you want someone else to facilitate who is trained in that process. And all these responses are perfect. So thank you again for participating in that. One of the ways I do want to like talk about is benefits of sharing stories. I did share some of them, and some of these may be repetitive, but I did want to name them again. Is you know, research shows like there are like, you know, sharing stories not just brings, you know, increases empathy, but it also brings communities together, increases in representation of stories, right? When we say representation is missing, or we don't see ourselves in many of the stories, I know we are talking about TV shows and movies, but also in terms of the stories that are visible in the mainstream, right? True personal stories. And this does not mean that I'm forcing, or, you know, I'm saying that you have to go and share your story with the world, but there are benefits that come out of this. Of course, only if the storyteller is ready and willing to share it in that capacity, right? Beyond yourself or beyond your family and friends. Sharing stories also improves physical and mental health. It improves well-being. Finding my own voice was one of the most beneficial things of storytelling. Like, I did not know my strengths. I did not, you know, just it helped me reaffirm my values, whether it aligned to the moment or whether it aligned to the work that I'm doing. And also influencing public policy, right? We use these success stories sometimes from our communities about how they have done work in the communities and how it has helped them personally and professionally for like applying for legislation, funding, public policy, right? So these are different ways that the benefits are definitely there, but again, not at the expense of the storyteller's health, right? Not at the expense of the storyteller, not in terms of like exploiting them. So this is on the assumption that the storytellers themselves have consented to and are willing to share their stories with a specific audience, right? So there are types of storytelling, and I know some of these things you may be already aware of it because, you know, majority of y'all have also been familiar with it, but we know that there are like audio, oral storytelling, written, digital one, video, right? Digital storytelling is what we shared the example. So you kind of have an idea. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. There may be other ways, maybe through TikTok or I don't know, any other forms of social media that I'm still very, very new to. There may be other forms of storytelling that may come up. The digital storytelling that I showed y'all, that was again, as I said, that was paired with a visual artist. But the digital storytelling that I got trained in is I am the one who creates a voiceover. I'm the one who writes a script about my story. I'm the one who does the voice recording and identifies images, background, everything to add to my story. So I'm finally the person who creates a short film about my own life, right? So it's a short first-person video narrative created by combining recorded voice, still and moving images, and music or other sounds. So one of the ways I like this process that is created by Story Center, and I feel that it can be applicable to not just digital storytelling, but also for other forms of storytelling. What's the story you want to share? Who do you want to share it with? At this moment, if your answer is like, I don't want to share it with anyone, it's just for myself. Or you'll be like, I want to share it with my youth. Or someone will be like, I just want to share it with my partner or my family, you know, that kind of thing, my chosen family, right? And then why do you want to share the story, right? As I said, like I shared that story about my grandmom because it was a 1-year death anniversary for her. And I was in the US and I was remembering her and missing her. That was important to me. And that's why the last question is, why share the story now? That is very helpful, especially if you have more than one stories you are thinking of and you are like, I don't know what to focus on. I don't know what story to share. I have these two different ideas, right? But the question that you can ask yourself is, why do you want to share this story and why now? And hopefully that will help you clarify that process. Again, this process can be used for other forms of storytelling as well. Story circles is something which I actually absolutely love about storytelling. As you may be already aware of, story circles, comes from the peacekeeping circles, which have, originated and created and practiced in Native and Indigenous communities and, by Native and Indigenous people and communities, right? It also stems from restorative justice practices, and increases visibility. It's an inclusive space as long as there's a trained facilitator who knows how to hold a talking, who knows how to hold a story circle, right? So you see these for support groups as well, but story circles focus mainly on their stories. It increases, again, as I said, visibility for each of the people who are speaking there. And there's also, it's also about creating those equitable spaces, right? Equal access that every storyteller has a right to share their story. And I love the idea of this. I know it looks different in virtual spaces, but there is still a process of doing that, right? By setting ground rules, by kind of creating this sacred space where everybody is able to feel comfortable, the stories shared in that circle do not leave that circle, right? Whatever shared there stays there. So these are some of the ground rules that you can identify as a storytelling facilitator, if you're planning to do a story circle in the future, I definitely encourage you to look into those authentic practices that stem from Native and Indigenous groups and not to co-opt it. Like, that's not the point. It's more about giving respect to that process and to the practices that were created by, again, Native American and Indigenous populations. So I definitely encourage you to check that out. I don't like story circles being mainstreamed and commercialized for that reason. We have another film, and I just want to make sure, give me one second. Okay. Sorry. Okay. We have another short film that I would like to show, and I'm also mindful of the time. Let's see. This is a film that I did not make it. It is by another storyteller. It is on YouTube. It is publicly accessible, I just want to give a trigger warning that it does mention suicide, sexual abuse, and substance misuse or substance abuse. And we will see this film right now. Let me see. So far, any questions? I wanted to make sure. Actually, let me just make sure there are no other questions. So far, so good. Okay, making sure there's nobody in. Okay, if you have any questions until then, please put it in the chat and I'll do my best to respond while we go through the process on the last 5 to 10 minutes. Definitely I'll make sure I address it. So let's go to see this film. And y'all can see my YouTube video now, right?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, thank you. I don't know, the subtitles are great. Sometimes it messes up, but let me know if you want me to turn them on.
Psychiatrists told me that bad impulse control, PTSD, OCD, my gender identity, and my sexuality landed me in the hospital 3 times for suicide attempts. I knew differently. The sadness had finally caught up to me. It felt like thunder rolling through me. A few times, my therapist asked me, "How do you want to make sense of what is happening? And how do you want to go forward?" But I wasn't sure if I wanted to go forward. For the first time, I was dealing with intense childhood trauma and assaults, and I couldn't imagine living with that. I went to the hospital, but not because I wanted to live or feel better. The people who loved me the most taught me that love is unconditional when they didn't give me the option to not go and fold in on myself. A fellow patient taught me that caring was possible when he brought me an orange and a sandwich when I was too sick from overdosing to eat with everyone else. During this time in therapy, I said, "I hate everything." My therapist said, "Well, do you hate blueberries?" And I said, "Okay, I guess I don't hate blueberries." And then he asked me what else I don't hate. Elephants, flowers, very old trees. Those things saved my life when looking into next week was too hard. I decided out of this time that I was going to be a therapist one day. I know that there are mental health professionals out there not doing a good job, especially for queer and trans folks, and I'm determined to be one of the good ones. I wasn't doing my life for myself yet, but for people like me who are getting hurt by a system that diagnoses and medicates when it should be listening and caring. Every time I paint, I let some of the hurt that I carry inside me rest somewhere else. I celebrate my goodness, and I celebrate that I'm here. My sadness doesn't roll and shake me like thunder as much now, but drips away cleanly like melting snow.
So how was the film? You can put it in the chat. I know it's a lot to process. Right. Inspiring, provocative. Michelle, I do see your question. I will be back at it for sure. Okay. Thank you, Caitlin, for sharing. So the Center for Digital Storytelling is now known as Story Center. So just to let you know that, yes, it was deep, absolutely. I want to get back to Michelle's question so I don't this. You live in a small town, volunteer for your organization. You want to use your voice and story to educate and inspire other survivors. I keep offering and asking to share my story, but get shut down at the local level. I was silent for over 40 years and I can't be silent any longer. What advice can you help? What advice can I give to help you share your story? One of the things, Michelle, definitely, I think it depends on if you are ready to share with a bigger audience, as you said, like on a local level. One of the things I would ask yourself, like, you know, encourage you to check in with yourself is about, do you see it being like a digital short digital film, like with, you know, like a voiceover, like the one that you saw right now? Or do you see yourself doing like an oral storytelling event or being a part of the radio, right? Like, who do you see your audience? I know you mentioned it local, but I want you to just check in terms of your readiness and your mental capacity. And even though you are like, yes, I'm ready, I'm willing to share, that's amazing. Oral story anywhere. Okay. One of the things I would encourage you to is not that you, so when I say about like taking a class, that does not mean that we need to be told how to tell the story, right? But it gives us a platform, or, you know, if you are able to reach out to any oral storytelling groups in your neighborhood or in your city, especially now when it's virtual that everybody can reach out to, you can absolutely like, so what I did was, let me give you my example. For example, I did reach out to there's a nonprofit organization in Sacramento called Capital Storytelling. I reached out to them and I took a class, even though I had digital storytelling experience, even though I've been a storyteller, right? And I knew what my story was. I was like, oral storytelling looked a little different to me. And I would have loved to, for someone to give me that, you know, support and shape or the guidance, right? So I know it's a little hard because not all oral storytelling classes and instructors have that trauma-informed training for these spaces, right? So I want to be mindful of that. One of the things I would suggest is, Michelle, maybe if you would like to like email me, maybe if I can request Maria to put my email address, and then I can correspond with you by email, if that's okay with you, to provide you some of these resources. I know there are some virtual classes that happen, and even like just connecting with any of the, you know, I want to know like where do you envision seeing, you know, sharing your stories, whether it's oral story, locally, right? So I think definitely I can give you some ideas and expertise based on what I've learned so far, right? And thanks, Maria, for sharing that. I'll be more than happy to provide you some, you know, some guidance in that matter, hopefully. Yeah. Thank you, Michelle. Let me check the time. Okay, we're good with the time. So one of the questions that I have is, again, please feel free to put it in the chat. The storytelling about blueberries, right? How does storytelling humanize prevention and make sexual and intimate partner violence relatable and personally identifiable? How would you use this story to humanize it? I know many of you spoke about humanizing these stories, especially as a survivor, right? And it doesn't have to be a survivor of just sexual violence or sexual abuse or domestic violence. It could be any other traumatizing experiences, because trauma looks different for everyone, right? So I just want to put the chat question there so you know, and feel free to like think about it, process it. And if you have any ideas of why do you think or how do you think the storytelling humanizes prevention, makes it more relatable. So adapting storytelling activities, I know now that the pandemic is kind of, a lot of cities and states, I actually, Colorado, I'm not sure about the situation right now. In California, you know, the state has reopened, people are like resuming the day-to-day activities, some offices are going back, but many of us are still in our virtual spaces, or we are in our hybrid spaces, right? Hybrid virtual spaces, some in person, some not. And many times I've been asked this question is, how do you adapt storytelling activities if we cannot meet in person? Or if we wanted to be more accessible to people who cannot travel right now, so we would like to do it on Zoom, for example. Or if you feel that digital storytelling feels like a lot of work right now, it feels like I don't have the time, I don't have the funding or the capacity to enroll in a digital storytelling workshop. For example, right? We all have been there. I've been there myself. So one of these things that you can do is if you're like talking with youth, or you're talking with some community members of yours, or with your staff, or with your advocates, right? You can use these different questions. You can tailor these different questions as, you know, to your potential storytellers. You can assess their needs and capacity. Use positive or neutral triggering prompts. And again, these prompts may be still triggering to many people. I want to be very aware of that. I'm very aware of that. I just want you to know that these can be still triggering to many, many people, especially in our communities, right? But you can ask any of these questions, right? Do you remember a time when you were told, you know, by someone that you inspired them, right? Or that your action or gesture made their day? Or if you had to write a short letter to your younger self describing your strengths or your awesomeness, like how awesome and incredible you have been and how resilient you have been. Or asking like, do you remember your, you know, talk about your favorite comfort food or homemade food, right? What is that one memory that you're able to think about it? So it could be positive and neutral triggering if you are not sure, if you're trying to build trust with your communities that are not used to storytelling, right? So those are some of the ways you can think about it. It may not, some of the questions or the prompts that you have used may not look like anything in this list. These are just examples to like how to frame your own prompts. Again, even though it's positive and neutral, or neutral prompts, it could still be triggering. So just be mindful of creating that space and letting people know that it's okay to react or provide them emotional support if you are able to, right? So storytelling may look like, you know, trauma-informed, accessible, affordable, creating alternatives. So for example, if you're working with youth, you can, or you know, anybody else, you can create artwork, you can create zines, photo storyboards, scrapbook, audio voiceovers, oral history projects. You can even ask them to be like on Zoom. For example, if I had to do this activity today, I could be like, hey, look out, you know, check out a photo from your cell phone that you would like to share a story about, something that you feel comfortable sharing with your peer. And I would be like, let's do it in breakout rooms, for example. Now, we are not doing it today, but I'm just giving you an example. And when they select a photo, you put them in breakout rooms, not more than three people, and each of them get to show, you know, either on the camera or not, but you get to describe the photo and you'll be like, what is the photo about, right? What happened that day? Why does it matter? You know, why this photo? Why did you select this photo? What were you feeling? Like, those are some of the questions that you can ask, right? Again, not too personal, not too intrusive or imposive, or, you know, that kind of questions, but something that you get an idea of what the visual description of what that photo looks like. And that could be a part of the storytelling activity. So it all depends on how you feel you want to adapt it to your communities. Again, you know, even though it's well-intentioned, but not at the expense of putting the storytellers at, you know, kind of intentionally putting them at any risk. Not that any one of us would do it, but I'm just putting it out there. And also culturally relevant and language accessible. Using a language they feel most comfortable writing and talking in. A lot of the digital storytelling workshops or the regular workshops have also been done in Spanish. They have been done in Hindi. They have been done in Cantonese, right? If that person is comfortable sharing in that, the language they are comfortable with, basically. And if you are able to arrange for interpreters or whatever it needs to make sure that the story is being shared with the audience, that would be awesome. That should be like the norm, not the exception, right? But I understand, like, sometimes we want to do all these things, but we don't have the funding, the capacity, all that. But I'm just saying that if you're thinking of it as a bigger picture, to create these spaces right from scratch, how do you plan it? You keep all these components in mind, is to make it culturally relevant and language accessible. Storytelling may also look like journaling. It may look like the doodle, you know, like doodling or graphics that were created by Chanel Miller. Maria has put the link to that. If you're not seeing the short film that Chanel Miller had created, if you are not aware, she's a survivor of the Brock Turner, she's a survivor in the Brock Turner sexual assault case, who had read her 12-page victim impact statement to her attacker in court. They were from Stanford University. So if you've not heard, you know, definitely check that short film. She uses doodling a lot for as a therapeutic tool, but also storytelling. And the next one is the image. As you see, there is an image of a person with a dress, knee-length dress, with, you know, like slippers or sandals. They have two grocery bags on either of the hands, and then one grocery bag, it's written, "I went to buy groceries and a man called me a slut." And the second bag says, "Then two men catcalled me as I walked home." Right? This is the image that was, you know, there's a graphic that was created by an artist, but it was posted on Stop Street Harassment. So if you have not heard of Stop Street Harassment, it's a national organization platform that, you know, creates space for people to share their street harassment experiences or street harassment traumatizing experiences on the website, but it also talks about tackling street harassment as a part of sexual violence. Maria has also posted the Instagram account for this image, if you're interested in checking. So just want to let you know, storytelling may also look like any of these if you don't want to do oral or digital storytelling. I know we have a polling question. What types of storytelling have you explored or would you be interested in exploring? Now that you kind of have some more information, hopefully added to your knowledge so far or your skills, I'm interested to know what, you know, where do you see yourself like getting more curious or, you know, excited about?
Great, and it is check all that apply. So make sure that you check all of the pieces that apply. So Meghna, it looks like the majority of folks are choosing all or a combination of some of these strategies. And then we also have quite a few people saying they want audio or in-person live storytelling. And then we have kind of a tie between digital storytelling and journaling, where 14% of folks are saying they want to engage in those types of storytelling ways. We have about 70% of folks who have voted. I'm going to leave it open for just a couple more seconds, give you all the opportunity to interact. And And it's not really shifting very much at this point. I'm going to go ahead and end the polling. I'm going to share the results. So it looks like folks are interested, Meghna. 71% of folks said all or a combination of some of these strategies, with the next one being audio or in-person live storytelling.
Thank you so much. And thank you, everyone, for participating in the poll as well. Phyllis could not see the polling options. Phyllis, if you saw any of the questions, we were basically just asking, you can put it in the chat. Maybe the pop-up did not come on your screen. What kind of storytelling were you interested in? Digital, audio, only video stories, journaling, or any combination of the strategies? So if you feel like posting the response to that. Thank you, everyone, for participating in the poll. So I want to be aware of the time, and I just want to talk about what does engaging and supporting our communities look like, right? We talk about engaging our communities, but we also how do we do that? Or why should we use storytelling, and how do we talk about engaging our communities? What does that look like? Many of us, again, may be familiar with this. It may not be new information. But that's something, I like to contextualize things. I like to put it in a broader framework or take a step back and be like, hey, what's the bigger picture about this? So for example, if we are thinking about storytelling, we have to think beyond an individual level of impact and how storytelling can be used to shift those, right? Think about how storytelling can be used to shift those levels beyond the individual. So if you see on this image created by Lydia Guy Ortiz in 2006, you can see some of the, the different kinds of oppression, right? You see the lighter circles and you can see the darker circles. The benefit of storytelling, or thinking about when you're bringing about, if you're interested in bringing storytelling in your community, you think about that storytelling can address the lighter circles right here. The lighter circles are what is typically unseen, hidden, or not taken as seriously, right? So it could be misogynistic practices, gender violence normalized. It could be rigid gender roles, sexist jokes, voyeurism, flashing, sexual exploitation, street harassment. Like, it could be any of these. So storytelling helps to address those lighter aspects, which again are not taken seriously. I'm not saying marital rape or sexual assault is taken seriously, but the more, it's more in the media, it's given more visibility. People are more, sharing their stories, which is great. That awareness is there, right? But when we talk about sexist jokes, people are like, I don't condone violence against women, but I will definitely share a sexist joke with my colleague, right? Do you see the whole this? So storytelling helps to address those nuances. That's my point. The community engagement part of it, I want you to think about in terms of what is your organization's vision, right, of community engagement? Are you listening to more than just who served, are you listening actively to more than those served by your community? To what extent are you listening to and learning from the community in both informal and formal ways? And what is your definition of community engagement, right? What do you think about storytelling, and what does community engagement looks like? Is it just a one-time thing, or do you want it to sustain your community interest? Do you want to sustain the interest of your stakeholders to be a part of the storytelling process or the storytelling program in your organization? What narratives do you want to shift? What part of prevention do you want to address? Do you want to talk about healthy sex and relationships? Do you want to talk about cultural norms or consent, right? Are you interested in talking about white privilege or feminism or movement building or about masculinity? It could range to a whole lot of topics. And it could be something you're like, hey, I just want people to come for the storytelling circle, and I'm not going to think about I'm not going to think about a theme or a topic, I just want people to come. It's community building, and that also is perfect, right? But it's also a part of the bigger prevention, especially when you're writing grants or if you're trying to collaborate with other agencies of collaborating in terms of creating these storytelling activities or using it for prevention. So that's why I like to usually share this, and this has been really helpful to a lot of people. Who's your priority audience? Is it your male-identified trusted adults, the men in your communities, parents and families? It could be youth or teens. It could be prevention educators. It could be culturally responsive agencies. So again, as I said, like storytelling, you know, for example, of the elderly serves multiple functions, right? It helps them, you know, reminisce and sharing of life stories. It helps improve their self-esteem, mood, enhances, you know, feelings of control and mastery over their life. So this is, again, different depending on who your priority audience is. It could be youth, about trust building, right? About talking about consent, healthy relationships. So this is not an exhaustive list, but this gives you an idea, hopefully, or an example of how it will look up, you know, how it will look like in your own communities. And I want to get to the next section. So I'm curious to know this, and I will get to the chat. I have seen a few responses there, so I'm not ignoring your responses. I do appreciate each one of you like mindfully taking the time to respond and write in the chat. But this is one of the questions, and again, if you don't have a response right now, it's something for you to think and take it with you, right? How will you facilitate, introduce, or support storytelling in your communities to prevent violence or to shift these social norms? How do you see yourself doing that? So I'm curious to know that, and we'll look into the chat in another few minutes. So I wanna be keeping in mind of the time, the ethical considerations and overcoming challenges, right? There are different concepts that there are different hurdles that come up while having these storytelling. So like trigger warnings, that could be a thing. Virtual disclosure, especially, you know, first time if they're talking about their experience with domestic violence or sexual experience, sexual harassment, for example. It could be storyteller's frustration with technology, especially if you're creating an online space, right? The storyteller's mind, they may change their mind, their consent may change. Funding, you'll be like, hey, I want to do this storytelling thing for a while, but we've just not got a grant, or we, you know, we applied for it, but the money is not, you know, they're not approved it or something like that. And staffing and resources, you know, as much as a facilitator or a person who's coordinating these logistics, that also takes efforts and time. You have to invest, you know, and sometimes we just don't have the staffing, or, you know, have the staff doesn't have the capacity to do that. So these are the potential hurdles. I don't want you to look at them as something like that is daunting and intimidating. But if you do end up like writing grants, partnering with other agencies, or partnering with youth agencies or any other agencies or communities, I want you to see that if you have an opportunity to be at the start of developing and designing or bringing storytelling in your community, is you think about some of these possibilities, right? Is about a funding, about staffing, capacity, everything, and even offering emotional support, for example. Like trauma-informed confidentiality and consent. Like a storyteller may or may not change their minds, right? To share a story in any format. Again, is your community or your organization ready or open to change? Teaching technology in virtual spaces means new risk and additional time and patience, right? Everybody has their own learning curve, space, and pace. Trauma-informed is also protecting people's safety, identity, and also assessing risks while sharing these stories. We need to honor the stories, the storytellers, by providing active deep listening, supportive feedback. Just remembering that this is not the trauma Olympics, right? This is not oppression Olympics through storytelling. Recognizing people have different capacity and emotional needs. So these are some of the things that, you know, it's always helpful from that point of view about, you know, how you can address some of these possible hurdles or hiccups that may come when you're thinking of creating a storytelling program or a session or a workshop, right? For storytelling with youth, ValorUS team had created this handout and a web conference, which I definitely encourage you to look at it. It's an archive web conference. Maria has posted the link. It was basically, it was not about storytelling with youth, but this was just one of the small components about best practices for mandatory reporting. So if you're doing storytelling with youth, there's a possibility that there will be an inadvertent disclosure of abuse, right? So just letting your storytellers know who is a mandated reporter there, inform storytellers about who is required to report, right? Discuss the power and impact. And also the fact that if they agree to put it on YouTube, just let them know about the consequences of digital footprints. You are not scaring them, but you're informing and educating them. You're empowering them with the choices that they can make, right? So this is something I definitely want you to be mindful of when we are, you may have already been doing this, but I definitely wanted to put it on your radar. Accessibility is, again, I've spoken about that. It's not just about, you know, providing closed captioning or, you know, ASL or language, also about, you know, interpretation, language interpretation. So, but also, you know, I think by creating it's one of those things that we realize that storytelling activities or workshops often have an absence of inclusive physically or digitally accessible spaces, right? So what capacity does your team have to provide emotional support language support or accessibility support, right? Who are your interested storytellers? And what, like, how do you create that inclusive accessible space to them? If it's one in person, for example, in the future, are you inviting your storytellers to a space that is ADA accessible, for example, gender neutral restrooms? It's more than that, but I'm just giving you some examples so that you know about it. It's important because they will know that they have been seen and you are creating the space that will encourage them to share their stories in a very safe, supportive, courageous space, right? Like one of the things I just want to do a quick recap is storytellers' readiness and consent. Again, as I spoke, like it is an ongoing consent. So if they've given you a consent today for like sharing, you know, their story on YouTube, I would definitely, before you put it on YouTube again, I would definitely encourage them to, you know, just check in with them to make sure their consent hasn't changed. Assessing the community readiness, they may be still hesitant to do the storytelling. Right? So you can find other ways of showing these films and maybe having a panel discussion to see how people react to these short films, for example. Creating trauma-informed spaces, so you get to define what trauma-informed looks like. If you do not have the emotional support to provide, you let them know and provide them a list of referrals, for example. If you do have someone to provide emotional support, then that's great. You create that space for them. Ethical practices and intentions is basically not, you know, I think not creating storytelling for like branding and marketing, not being exploitative from that point of view. And if you are planning, I know, not that we are going to be doing it. So, but it, that's what it means, like in terms of ethical practices and intentions, like the stories shared there are going to be between them, unless they say that, yes, put it on YouTube, right? Just kind of allowing anonymity for storytellers if they have asked you, you know, that please keep my story anonymous. There are ways to do that as well. Accessibility and capacity, I spoke about that. And sustaining community engagement. Again, do you see storytelling as a one-time thing or beyond that? How do you plan to sustain that? And it comes back to the bigger picture is why storytelling? Why do you want to do storytelling? And that usually helps answer a lot of questions for yourself about why you want to do it in your communities. I know we have like 2 minutes left. I appreciate everybody sharing your chat responses to the chat. I've been reading them in my mind, but not being able to share it online. Sharing it aloud. But thank you, Phyllis, for sharing that you'd like to do several types of storytelling. You'd like to learn more about digital storytelling. Yes. I would encourage you to check out storycenter.org. They have free web conferences about what digital storytelling is about. And if you have any questions, feel free to let me know. I also have done digital storytelling workshops for other state coalitions for their advocates. So if there is something that you're like, you know, if you want to reach out to me, then feel free to like, you know, reach out to me and I'm happy to, we can talk about it. That's my point. So I hope this was helpful. If there's something that I did not cover or if you have any questions, let me know.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Meghna. This was all really great. We're happy and glad that you were able to spend your morning with us and sharing your insight and your expertise with us around storytelling and using that for primary prevention. I also want to thank you all for being here engaging with us during today's webinar. I do want to remind you all, any questions that you have that weren't answered, feel free to reach out to Meghna. I'll be sending a follow-up email by the end of the day today with PDF slides of the session today, as well as Meghna's email address. So keep an eye out for that. Please remember to fill out the survey. There will be a link in that email as well. That's really helpful for us to share with our presenters, but also to know what else you're looking for from us as CALCASA for future webinars. Speaking of future webinars, we do have another one scheduled for July 15th, titled Creative Advocacy. We have Joyce Aubrey, who's author and founder of Finding Our Voices, who will be joining us at 10 a.m. again on July 15th. So keep an eye out for that. We hope to see you all at future CALCASA webinars. Keep an eye out for future communications around this webinar and others. And we're so glad you were able to make it. Have a good rest of your day, everyone.